Jesus, you are my King.
amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you in all I do. In all I do, I honor you. Over the mountains and the sea, your river runs with love for me, and I will open up my the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hands, for I will always sing when your love came down. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love. Sing of your love forever. Over the mountains and the sea, your river runs with love for me, and I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hands, for I will always sing of sing of your love forever. I can 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 sing of your love. Sing of your love forever. I can sing of your love forever. Oh, I feel like dancing. It's foolishness, I know. But when the world has seen the light, they will dance with joy like we're dancing now. Sing of your love forever. I can 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 sing of your love forever.
All right, before you sit down this morning, turn around and pray.
when I cannot stand, I fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and save. Lord, I need
consider their own conversion, their own life in Christ, and whether they've experienced the new life that comes in Jesus. And also the work of conversion, the work of bringing other people to Jesus and making disciples. And so we looked at that last week, and now we're going to look at the first steps now in Saul's walk with God. Last week we looked at the conversion. Now the immediate aftermath of that, the follow-up of that, what happens next in the life of Saul. And so what we're going to consider is the fact that we look at the story and we're going to see something that maybe would be surprising to us today. And that is that Saul, who was persecuting believers, who was involved in killing Christians, who was arresting them just days before, is going to very, very immediately become a missionary for the Lord. He's going to begin very much at the moment of his conversion, begins to do the work that God has given him, which is maybe somewhat surprising to us. I mean, shouldn't he have to go through some kind of testing period or confirmation classes or something to prove that in truth he is a follower of Jesus? But we're going to see that he immediately goes to work for the Lord. And so what we're going to be challenged with today is that thought, is that what does it take to serve? I mean, when can I begin to serve? When someone comes to Jesus, is it okay for them to serve? Or when should they serve? And then the other end of that is, and maybe you feel this fits more with you, and that is, when can I quit serving? When is it the right time to, okay, hang it up and just kind of coast the rest of the way to the finish line that is the Christian life? And that's what we're going to look at today, and hopefully you're going to be challenged in one way or another. When my family goes on little getaways, and it used to be much more prominent than this, but we still kind of work this in. We used to always kind of work in like historic stops. If I saw something interesting, we would pull over and we would check it out. And so we still tend to, when we get away on little vacations, like to stop and read signs and visit areas of historical significance. And so this week we were away for a few weeks with the Corneliuses, and we went up to Erie. I've never been to Erie, but while we were visiting there, one day we were in a campsite right near the bay, the lake there, and I saw this real old ship going by. I mean, like real old, like 1800s, 1700s going by in the channel. And I was like, look at that boat. And I jumped on my bike and I rode around where I could get a closer look and take pictures of it. And it had 15 stars on the flag, and it had an interesting other flag that said, don't give up the ship. And I didn't know what it was. I knew it was something historically significant, but I didn't know what it was. So we got to looking around. We found that there's a ship there docked in Erie that during the War of 1812, that the Great Lakes, the British dominated the lakes with their naval fleet. And the United States didn't really have a fleet, so they decided they were going to compete for the Great Lakes if they were going to win the War of 1812. And so they very quickly put together a navy, and it was built essentially there in Erie. And there was a ship called the Niagara, and it was involved in this critical battle that the American forces under Oliver Perry defeated the British forces in a decisive way that pretty much just wrapped up the War of 1812. It pretty much took control of the Great Lakes region for the United States, which led to the victory. So we got to visit that and see that and found out that boat that I saw was a replica of the Niagara that travels around the coast. It's docked in Erie for a while, and then it travels over to the Cleveland area. But anyway, it's kind of an interesting thing. But I found this out, I thought this was really interesting, that when the War of 1812 ended, and they had successfully won the Great Lakes region, that they did what they did commonly in those days. And they took that ship, the Niagara, and so considering that they might want to use it again someday, here's what they did, they sunk it. They sunk it in the bay there at Presque Isle. And that was so, they felt that if that ship was underwater in the cold, deep water, that it would actually retain better. It would be less detrimental than sitting in a dry dock where it's going to be exposed to the weather and drying out. And I guess there was sense to that. It didn't make sense to me, but that was the thinking. And so they would take a ship like that and they would sink it. They would sink it to the bottom, and then if, you know, 15 years down the road they needed it again, they would bring it up. So what they did with this boat was they didn't really need it again, but at the 100-year anniversary they decided to bring the boat up. And so they did, and it was incredibly deteriorated, as I would expect it would be. And so they brought it up, and they found that it was really not usable, but they spent a lot of time and effort restoring it. They got it to where they could actually float it around. They wouldn't sail it, but they would pull it behind another boat around the lake in a kind of a tour kind of thing. Well, eventually that ship was unable to put it, to maintain it, and so they built a replica that's there today. But I thought it was interesting when I read that. I would have never considered that before. But I thought, you know what, as I was listening to the story, as I was thinking about it, and in connection to the text that we're on today, I thought, well, there's a great parallel there for the Christian life. Because when we become followers of Christ, it is like we have just been built. God is creating us, He's making us, He's preparing us for that, to be set out in that sail, to set sail. And we have this thinking, well, you know, everything's not in place yet. God hasn't got everything lined up at this point for me. He hasn't got me right where I need to be before I can really be effective for Him, where I can really set out into the lakes. And so we have this tendency to keep waiting, to keep waiting, keep waiting for that perfect moment when I'll be ready to set sail. I'll be ready to do the work that God has given me. Well, Martin Luther said it this way. He says, "For truth and duty, it is ever the fitting time. Who waits until the circumstances completely favor his undertaking will never accomplish anything." And I see that, I look around the church and I see, boy, there's a big chunk of us. I mean, I fell into that category for a period of time, where I'm waiting for just the right moment. And that moment never comes. Because it is always the right moment. Right now is always the time. And so many people do that, though. They're waiting. They're expecting that, you know, there's going to be this moment when I'm perfectly equipped and ready to go. And yet, we're going to see that is not accurate. The other thing is this, and that is that, boy, I've been serving the church for so long, it's time just to sink me to the bottom, right? You know, just fill me up and set me down. And if you need me, hey, I'll be sitting in the mud. And you can lift me up. You can, you know, maybe, you know, polish the deck a little bit and set me back out. Put the mask back up. So anyway, that there's a big section of that in the church where we kind of looked at it. I've been serving. You know what? It's time for the kids to work at this. It's time to get them involved and let them resume and take over the responsibilities. But here's the thing. God has a place for every Christ follower. He has a place and a purpose for every Christ follower. It doesn't matter if you just stepped in today or if you've been following Jesus for 60 years. He has a place for you to be serving, a place for you to be for doing the work that he has given you to do. And so what we're going to look at today is that how that occurs, when is the right time, and how that occurs. How God prepares you to get you ready to the mission that he's given you. And so we're going to look at Acts chapter 9. We're going to be beginning at verse 19 and looking at verses 31. And I remind you, this is right after Saul has been saved. It's right after he's come to know Jesus. And so we're not talking about it like years. We're looking at it right away, what he is doing as a follower of Jesus. And before we read that this morning, though, let's pray together. Father, I thank you that we can be together today. Thank you, God, just for the blessing it is to fellowship together. God, it is just such an encouragement, such a blessing to be here each week, to see the passion and the hunger, God, on your people's faces as I have the privilege of sharing your word. And I pray today, Lord, that wherever each of us are, God, right at that place, you would come and meet us there and minister to us. As we consider what you desire of us in service, Lord, I pray that you would help us to capture that vision you have for us so that we can faithfully serve you. Lord, if we've been delaying, if we've been waiting for that perfect moment, God, help us to see that perfect moment is now. Lord, if we've been serving and we're just tired of serving and we just want to ride the waves for a little while, just take it easy, Lord, light a fire in us. Help us, God, to see the critical need to serve you in the world today. And we just thank you, and we pray these things all in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, here's what it says in Acts chapter 9, beginning with verse 19. It says, "And after taking some food, he regained his strength." So we're talking about right away. He just got healed. He just had his eyesight returned. "Saul spent several days with the disciples in Damascus. At once he began to preach in the synagogues that Jesus is the Son of God." Okay? At once, right? Several days, he got some food, got his strength back, he's got his sight back now. Several days, spends a little time with the disciples. At once, he begins preaching, okay? Now, I think that's really in itself very interesting, because when it comes to preaching, I mean, we're not talking about just, you know, he became an usher. And I don't say that to minimize ushering, but what I'm saying is that there's certain things in the church that we would look at and think, oh, okay, I can do that. You know, I could pass the offering plate. I could fold bulletins. I don't know, you know, whatever. There are these things that we would look at and think, you know, that's kind of simple. That wouldn't be too hard. I could probably do that. He doesn't do that. He immediately begins preaching. And so, right away, Saul was preaching. Okay, then he goes on to say this. "All those who heard him were astonished and asked, 'Isn't he the man who raised havoc in Jerusalem among those who called on this name? And hasn't he come here to take them as prisoners to the chief priest?'" So they know exactly what he's about. They know who he is. They recognize his name and his face. This is the guy who was, as it says, wreaking havoc against the church. He was arresting people. And so the question is that really him? Verse 22 then says, "Yet Saul grew more and more powerful and baffled the Jews living in Damascus by proving that Jesus is the Christ. After many days had gone by, the Jews conspired to kill him. But Saul learned of their plan. Day and night they kept close watch on the city gates in order to kill him. But his followers took him by night and lowered him in a basket through an opening in the wall. When he came to Jerusalem, he tried to join the disciples, but they were all afraid of him, not believing that he was really a disciple." And so look, this guy's got a two-pronged attack that he's facing. He's facing those from outside, and he's facing those from inside. And when I say outside and inside, I'm talking about the church. And we're going to dig into that a little bit as we work through this. When he came to Jerusalem, he tried to join the disciples, but they were all afraid of him, not believing that he was really a disciple. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles. He told them how Saul, on his journey, had seen the Lord and that the Lord had spoken to him, and how in Damascus he had preached fearlessly in the name of Jesus. So Saul stayed with them and moved about freely in Jerusalem, speaking boldly in the name of the Lord. He talked and debated with the Grecian Jews, but they tried to kill him. When the brothers learned of this, they took him down to Caesarea and sent him off to Tarsus. Then the church throughout Judea, Galilee, and Samaria enjoyed a time of peace. It was strengthened and encouraged by the Holy Spirit. It grew in numbers, living in the fear of the Lord. And so what we want to understand today is this, and that is that the time for the disciple to begin serving is today. There is never a perfect moment, or I should say, the perfect moment is always today. There's not going to come a time when the stars are perfectly aligned, and that is the moment when you begin to serve. It is always today. Now, it might change. That what God has intended for you, the way that He's intended for you to serve today, is in all likelihood different than it is maybe 10 years from now. But the truth is, today's the day when it comes to serving. That there is no reason for us to be sitting around waiting for something to happen, because whatever it is that God has put before us, today's the day to begin with. And Saul sees that and seizes on that as a Christ follower. And so, as we look at this, we might ask the question, though, well, how am I prepared for that? Maybe I understand that, but surely God has some kind of preparation time for me. And He does. Now, we look at Saul's life, he's a great example of that. Because immediately he begins to serve. There isn't preparation in the sense that he's going to go through training, even though he is going to go through training. But there isn't, okay, you got to do this first, and then you can serve. It is serve right away, and then begin the preparation. And so the same thing's true about us. As you look around the church, and you think, I'd like to serve, I'm just not sure how to serve, what you need to do is you begin to serve. And in your service, God will begin the preparation. He'll begin to shape you and change you and make you into an even more effective servant, an even greater servant. Just we're going to jump back to another place in Scripture here to show you a little bit about the preparation. Because the time is now. Saul doesn't wait around. He immediately begins to serve. He immediately begins to preach. But that doesn't mean there's not going to be a preparation. Doesn't mean that God's not going to do something in his life and working. Here in Galatians 1, verses 15 through 18, here's what it says. It says, "But when God, who set me apart from birth and called me by his grace, was pleased to reveal his Son in me so that I might preach him among the Gentiles, I did not consult any man." Stop there a second. This is Paul writing his letter to the Galatians. And he's making an interesting statement. He said, when God called me, he didn't use other people to call me. He himself called me. He went directly to me and called me. He says, "Nor did I go up to Jerusalem to see those who were apostles before I was. But I went immediately into Arabia and later returned to Damascus. Then after 3 years, I went up to Jerusalem to get acquainted with Peter and stayed with him 15 days. Now, there's a couple of things happening here. There is a preparation that is purely between Paul and God. There's a preparation that only God can do and only God is doing. And so it begins with this. We make this the next point, is the disciple is prepared for service through a deeper relationship with God. As we begin to serve, right away, today, immediately, then begins this process of deepening our relationship with God. And so you want to know, what can I do to prepare for service? Here's the first most important thing, and it is your relationship with God. It is, do you know Jesus? How well do you know Jesus? How can you get to know Jesus? And so through that growing relationship will prepare you more and more for ministry. You begin serving right away, but then you begin preparing. And you prepare by cultivating that relationship with Christ. And we see that in the life of Paul. And this is the only place this is mentioned in Scripture, because we might hear in the book of Acts get the idea that he simply, God spoke to him, and boom, he went to work and never did anything more in preparation. But we see that he spent a time away. He went away for 3 years. And so it's a time of preparation. It was a time of getting him ready. And so I think a great testimony to the fact that God wants us serving right away, but he also wants us working and moving to grow in him, to sharpen our skills and our relationship with, with God Himself. And so, we are prepared by working at deepening that relationship with God. The greatest thing you can do to make yourself more effective and more useful to God is to pursue God in your life. That's the most important thing. You want to go to seminary? Awesome. Go to seminary. You want to go to some new training? You want to learn how to effectively share Christ? All of that? Awesome. Go for it. Do it. But the most important thing, the most important factor in service and becoming a servant to God is your relationship with God. The greatest preparation will be the moments that you spend with God in the present that will prepare you for the future. And so, does that mean that that's the only part? That's the only way that Paul was prepared, simply by spending time with God? Well, that isn't the case. In fact, I would even say this, that his time before God, before he knew Jesus, was a time of preparation. He knew the Scripture. He knew the Old Testament. He was a Pharisee. He was a faithful Jew. And even though he did not know Christ, that was a seminary training for him. That was a means of learning what God's plan and seeing how God's plan fit together from Old Testament to New Testament. And so, the second thing we see this in the story is this. And that the disciple is also prepared for service through the fellowship of the church. As we see in this, he's surrounded by other believers. And other believers have a part in this. And we, in the very infant stages of his walk with Jesus, he has a very critical encounter with Ananias. And then this guy, Barnabas, walks into the picture, and he plays a critical role. And so the church always is a part of Saul's preparation. It is that fellowship of believers around him that is also preparing him for ministry. Here's what it says in Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 and 12. It says this, "It was he who gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, and some to be pastors and teachers, to prepare God's people for works of service, so that the body of Christ may be built up." You know what he's saying? He's saying he has equipped the church in certain ways. He's put people in positions. He's made pastors. He's made missionaries. He's made all these different service gifts in the church in order to prepare you, to build you up, to equip and shape the believer, the disciple, for what reason? Acts of service. And so the church itself helps to shape and prepare the Christ follower to serve. And it's one of the reasons, one of the many reasons why church attendance is important. Because you can deepen your relationship with Jesus on your back porch. You can. You can sit there and do devotions and sing praises to God and enjoy communion with Him. And that will prepare you for service. But you can't get the fellowship there. You're not going to get the fellowship of the church. You're not going to have those who God has put in a position to build you up, to equip you, to strengthen you. They are not going to be there to help you with that. And so we are prepared through that fellowship in the church. And so Saul has this reputation, though. And I mean, this is tough starting out for him. I think this is really interesting that he is going to start out in a way that everybody knows his name. Everybody knows who he is. And that's going to make it really difficult for him. Because there are those who used to be his friends, those who are the Jews, that are not happy with what he's saying now. And so they got a real problem with him. Okay, now the Christ followers, the disciples, those that know Jesus, they saw him dragging people off to prison. They saw Stephen stoned while Paul holds the coats. I mean, they knew his reputation before. And so he's like in a really tough position. Because those that are outside the church, they despise him. In fact, they want to kill him. Those that are inside the church, they don't trust him. They think this is just some game to get more of them, to arrest more of them. So he's in a really difficult position. And because of that, he's going to face opposition. And so, here's the next thing in preparation. If you're thinking about serving, you're not serving, you need to know this and understand this. The disciple will face opposition from the world. And I believe this is true. If you are an effective disciple, you will face opposition from the world, even more opposition from the world. If you are coasting along and you are not accomplishing anything for Jesus, really, the world's not going to get too upset with you. The people that the world is getting upset with today are those that are talking about Christ, those that are making a difference. That's the people that the world is going to get upset at. Those that oppose Christ are going to get upset if you are actually accomplishing something for Jesus. You know, I have friends on Facebook, and when I say friends, I use that a very literal or very liberal Facebook kind of meaning. You know what I mean? Facebook friends doesn't necessarily really mean friends. It means that we're connected through a social network. And then there are actually pastors. And I read some of the things they say, and I'm like, holy mud, you know, how lost can you be? And I think, you know what? They're not going to face any opposition to the world. Because they're really saying the same thing that the world's saying. There's no disagreement. There's no problem. They're not stirring the pot. They're not saying anything that's going to cause anybody to get upset. There's lots of churches like that today. There's lots of places out there that you want to just go and coast and have an easy time. And the world's not going to threaten you. The government's not going to threaten your right, your tax exempt status or anything like that, if that's what you want. But that's not what God wants. And so we need to understand that if we are going to be effective, if we are going to serve God in the way that He wants us to, that we will face opposition. And when we face persecution today, we tend to look around and we think of it, oh, this is weird, this is odd. Why would this be happening to me? I'm doing what God wants me to do. Why would I face opposition? And yet, the scripture very clearly says that when you're doing the things that God wants you to do, that you will face persecution. That's what it says. I was talking to Dave Hildebrand the other day. He was one of the founding officers here of Crossview. And he said this, we were talking about the world today and what it seems to mean for the church. And he said, these are exciting times to be living as a Christian. You know, and looks at the persecution, the challenges that are coming against the church, and he says, these are exciting times. I agree with him, but I'm kind of frightened by that fact. You know, it's not real exciting to think about what the church might be facing in the very near future, but are these exciting times? Absolutely. The next thing that we see, and this is maybe kind of the disheartening part of this in this story, and that is this, that Saul also is going to face opposition from the church. That's harder to take. You know, when we think about the world and Satan being against the church, that makes sense to us. And we understand that, and maybe we can even come to expect that. But what's hard is that there's opposition comes within the church. That we get factions, we get those who think they have a better way, and we have differences of opinion, and all of a sudden within the church we were standing against one another. And that's what Saul walks into. He's looking at that in this position. Not only does he get the pressure from the world, he's got the church. He said, you know what? I don't really trust him. I think he's up to something. Isn't this the guy? And so he is facing that challenge here in the early days of his ministry, opposition from the church. You know, one of the things that Teresa and I were just talking about is with our new facility that we're moving, and I didn't even share anything with today, but really progressing. The block is over half of the way done. It's coming around the front of the building now. The big windows are in the what will be the sanctuary activity room there. And it's really exciting, it's really cool. But one of the things that you see in big building projects in churches, there's almost always division. There's almost always problems come up when we go through something of that magnitude. And I look at this, and I haven't seen much of that in a church like this. We had some little bumpy moments there at various times, and especially a few months ago. But in truth, it's been pretty smooth sailing. There has been a real, what's the word I'm looking for? Everyone's on the same page. Everybody is is committed to the same purpose in this. That's been a blessing. But the truth is, whenever you undertake something big, it brings up division and factions in the church. And that can be really problematic. And so Paul, in the early days of his ministry, he's looking at that. He's not only got people on the outside, he's got people on the inside that are raising up against him. And so the disciple has to be prepared, not simply for opposition from the world, but also opposition from the church. Now, there's a right way to handle that, and we're not going to dig into that today, but we need to understand that. That is the truth, because we are simply saved sinners, and that introduces those problems into the church. So, look what happens next in this, is the world is coming against Paul. They want to get rid of him. They want to knock him off before he ever has a chance to make any real difference in the world. And so they immediately set out to kill him, which is interesting, because it was his thinking too. The way you get rid of Christianity is by killing them. And that continues to be the thought process outside of the church today. And so the thought was, we'll get rid of it and we'll kill him. We'll just cut this off right now. And so what happens is that the Christ followers, the disciples, come around him. And they offer a protection to him. They're going to make sure that the world isn't able to get to him at this point. And so the next thing is this. And that is that a disciple needs the protection that comes from the fellowship of the church. Saul needed that. He was going to need that kind of that moment in utero when he was protected from the outside world, where he could grow, he could mature, and God could let him loose into the world to do what he needed to do. But he needed protection at those moments in our life. And here is the truth. You need protection. Part of the reason that you need to be a part of the fellowship is you need protection. Now, I mean, I'm not saying the world's trying to kill you, but I can tell you this, the world wants to take you down, that Satan wants you to fall, that Satan wants to cause you to make a wreck of your life and the decisions that you make. He wants to take that and destroy your testimony. And one of the things that the church and the fellowship of the church offers is protection from that. When you live apart from fellowship with other believers, you're very susceptible to the temptations of the world. To be drugged down, to be taken down, and to be rendered ineffective in ministry. And for that reason, you need fellowship. If only for that reason. There's more reasons than that. But part of the reason for fellowship is protection. You are protected from the difficulties and challenges that come from the world. The next thing we see in this, because not only was he facing the opposition, and so he needed protection from the opposition of the world, but he also needed help in regards to the opposition that was coming from inside the church. And all of a sudden, here comes this guy, steps into the picture, by the name of Barnabas. Now, we'd heard Barnabas' name earlier in the book of Acts because he sold some property and given it to the church. So we knew a little bit about Barnabas, but not a lot. But here, Barnabas surfaces for the first time, and we begin to see who he really is. And the name means son of encouragement. And so he steps into this moment when the church is looking at Saul. They are looking at him with great skepticism. Don't trust him. And he steps in and he says, look, I know his testimony. I've heard him preach. I know what he's about. I believe this is real. I believe that he is the real deal. And he plays an incredibly important role in helping the church to see and to accept Saul, who would become the Apostle Paul. The next reason, the next need that we have that's met in the fellowship is that the disciple needs the encouragement that comes from the fellowship of the church. You need that encouragement. You need those hugs and those words of affirmation that you get when you come together with other believers. You might not think you need those things, but you really need those things. You will never know the encouragement that you mean to me, that you make to me, in simple gestures on Sunday morning that make it not just make it exciting to come to church the next week. The encouragement that's found in a smile and a hug and a handshake and a word is incredibly important to me. And if it's important to me, I am absolutely certain that it is important to every one of you. It is as necessary for you as it is for me. So many people at the door, when we hug at the door and say, have a great week, so many people say words and things that maybe you never even really thought a whole lot about, but they are incredibly important to me in encouraging me in ministry. This week we had the opportunity to go away, and we've been for multiple years now. We usually go away on a little short camping trip with the Corneliuses, and we did this week. And we made it 100 miles from home. We made it to Brookville, and our truck broke down. And so I'm sitting along Interstate 80, and these 18-wheelers are blowing by, and the camper's doing that. And really incredibly discouraging, and within a few hours, Doug Cheater shows up with his rollback, and Ken Zimmerman gives us his truck and says, just go take the camper and keep going, you know, go away. And so all of those kind of things that we're surrounded by in the fellowship of this church, and let me tell you, that is so encouraging to me. I don't feel like I'm off alone, that I'm fighting this battle by myself. We're part of a fellowship of people that love and care about us. And that is just so necessary in all of our lives. If you're going to serve God, you need that encouragement from other people. And that's what God wants for us. The disciple needs the encouragement that comes from the fellowship of the church. And so we get to the end of this and we see this. And we see something that we've seen over and over in the book of Acts. And what does it say? And the church continued to grow over and over again. I mean, they were just trying to kill him. I mean, to the point where they had to sneak him out of the city, put him in a basket, and get him out of the city. And even when he went someplace else, they wanted to kill him there too. And yet, the church keeps growing. And the church keeps growing. I think that's part of the reason that Dave Hildebrand said, these are exciting times. Because we see this. When it gets difficult and persecution really starts to get real, that's when it's separated. That's when the nominal believer is separated from the true believer. When things get hard, then we see the truth of our fruit. We begin to see the reality of our walk with Christ. And what happens in this case is the church grows. Church growth results, it occurs when the church faithfully serves. When I look around this building, I say that I don't see one face. There's not one face here that if you are a follower of Christ, that you're not called to serve in some way. There's nobody I can lock eyes with this morning that isn't a part of that, that isn't called to that. And when a church gets that and understands that and is willing to serve, when individuals are willing to serve wherever it is that God wants them to serve, there will be church growth. People are going to come to Christ. People are going to become a part of the fellowship and be concerned about making other people aware of Christ and the need for Christ in their life. And so the challenge we finish with today is this. Are you serving? Are you doing what God created you to do? And so as you go home today and as you spend that time on your back porch, on your deck, wherever it is that you spend time fellowshipping with God and doing your devotions, I want you to really prayerfully consider that. Am I serving God? And if not, how can I serve God? What role does he have for me to play? We're ready to open another facility. You know what that means? That means we need more servants. I didn't come up with this message today because we need more servants. We just need more servants, and that happens to be where we're at in the book of Acts. The truth is, we're going to need more Sunday school teachers. We're going to need more people that are willing to be ushers. They're willing to run the sound equipment. Those kind of things, we need people for that. We need servants. And so as you sit down and you spend time deepening your relationship with God, you know, be challenged. Ask God to show you. How do you want me to serve? Show me where it is you want me to be, Lord, and faithfully take me there. You know, here's the day. Today is the day. Today's the day that the Lord wants you to begin to serve. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your word and the challenge that's found in it. And I pray, Lord, that as we close today, as we take this message from here into this new week, that we will truly consider, we will truly be challenged by the thought, how is it that you want me to serve? Am I serving, Lord? Am I simply waiting and waiting and waiting to be ready to get out there and serve? Or Lord, if that's the case, then help me, Father, this week to begin to take a step into service. Lord, if I'm one of those people that's sitting on the bottom, that kind of feels like I've been used and don't have a lot more to offer, Lord, help reclaim me, bring me back. Help me to see that, God, you have a plan for me as long as I believe, as long as I live, to serve you. We thank you today. Pray, Lord, your greatest blessing as we close this time together. And we pray these things all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's stand. Pray these things all in Jesus' name.